will sail smoothly? Let us see. So the topic for today's session is about Hyperledger Fabric, which is a permission blockchain. I will not bore you again and again with the definition of blockchain, what it is and all, but yeah, I would definitely like to have your attention on these keywords which we are focusing on when we are discussing about blockchains. Yes, it maintains a distributed ledger which is accessed by a group of entities. However, the problem is that the entities do not have full trust on each other. They don't trust each other. And because of that reason, they need to some mechanism to agree upon where they use peer-to-peer protocol to share their transactions without any centralized authority. So it's a distributed ledger. It works on a decentralized environment. You have a peer-to-peer protocol. They don't have trust on each other, but still they agree using some consensus mechanisms. The other beauty of blockchains is that compared to centralized mechanisms, they don't have a single point of failure. And even if one or two nodes in the blockchain malfunction, disappear, or some nodes get added to the network, that will not affect the functionality of the whole group as a single entity. And however, I'm sure except for the previous session, we have been discussing about public blockchains or, you know, Bitcoin blockchain for a period of time, at least for the first 4 or 5 years when Bitcoin was introduced. People started imagining Bitcoin and blockchain as synonymous things. They feel that Bitcoin and blockchain are the same. But then after, Bitcoin was somewhere introduced around 2008 and 2009, after 5 years of 2013 onwards, the usage of Bitcoin has gone far beyond that. Enterprises have started adopting blockchain for various business applications. And right now the scenario, see, from 2013, we are almost into 22, almost 10 years, a decade. Now, you name any application that is there in the industry, blockchain is there. Healthcare, blockchain is there. Cloud computing, blockchain is there. Supply chain management, blockchain is there. Financial industry, blockchain. Banking, blockchain. What else? IoT, blockchain. So you name any to mind, blockchain is it, but only thing that I want all of you to make a note is that while you are introducing blockchain into an area, into a domain, please remind what are those features of blockchain that you are expecting. Blockchain, I'll also tell it, generally tell it in every session or talk that I take with respect to blockchains. Blockchain is not a single point solution for all the problems that we have in this world. Right? Generally, that happens whenever a new technology enters into the industry. We feel that it is a single point solution for every problem that we have in the world. No, blockchain is not a single point solution. It do addresses certain problems that we have in various domains. And what are the features that are exhibited by blockchain?
Madam, shall I interrupt you?
Yes, please.
I have a little bit doubt on this. Why researchers, when they proposed that blockchain concept, particularly they worked with a distributed ledger, but why they moved into distributed nature? What sort of advantages they had?
You're asking why distributed ledger in blockchains?
Yeah, why they moved into distributed nature?
Sorry, can you repeat the question? Like, what is it that you are asking about distributed the ledgers or the network?
Database only. Why they moved into distributed database?
Why into distributed database? Because the world is moving towards distributed systems. No longer are people working in the same place. So as long as you have distributed systems into the world. Rather than
even internet, internet fall on distributed nature only.
Right.
You know that. But, right. But the question is, the blockchain, why they are correlating? There are some specific reasons.
Yeah, why is blockchain formulated using distributed system?
Yeah, that is my question.
Why not? See, blockchain is formulated using a distributed ledger because there are issues. Okay, I'll come to your slide. Yes, I think I have a correct slide for you.
Okay, just okay, no problem.
2 minutes, I'll come
yeah,
to
no
that
problem.
Part.
No
okay,
problem.
Why is centralized and why not? Why
yeah.
not?
Thing?
I'll come to that part.
Okay,
okay just
you.
Let me finish the intro part.
No, no,
I
no,
definitely
no,
have
problem.
A slide for that.
Okay.
So these are the various key concepts that we use. In business scenario, see, I'm not talking about Bitcoin blockchain because there are a few limitations in Bitcoin blockchain. If you all see the all the hype that we have got for blockchains is because thanks to Bitcoin. But then what is it that we can do in Bitcoin is limited. You can do a cryptocurrency transaction. But if you see the status of cryptocurrency as of now in India, India has not legalized cryptocurrency. Right. So there are many concerns when it comes into a political scenario and a financial scenario on to accept cryptocurrencies and all. But however, the usage of blockchains is not limited to bitcoins and cryptocurrencies. It goes way beyond that. That's the reason people started implementing blockchains for various business applications where they use these four key concepts. One is the distributed ledger, the shared ledger. So the beauty of the shared ledger is that there is one single system of record which is shared across the business networks. It's not that no one has single control on it. It is a distributed system. It is a distributed ledger. Everyone can have keep their transactions. I will just modify that. I will say everyone can keep their approved transactions on this ledger. Anybody from anywhere in the world can verify those transactions. Well, in the sense, they provide so much of transparency that the transactions are available on the distributed ledger. Anyone can verify them. Anyone can validate those transactions. Now, when we are moving to business applications, the smart contracts are introduced, which are not there in Bitcoins, where the functionality of the transaction logic was decoupled from the blockchain. It was kept as a separate module known as smart contracts, where you embed all the whatever logic that you want to do in your transaction, you embed it as a logic and you execute it on the transactions. So I have my logic, I can do certain set of functions with my smart contract. You give my input, based on the inputs, I execute different functions in my smart contract. Other thing is security. All the transactions are visible across the ledger everywhere. However, they are secure, authenticated and verifiable. So secure in the sense the transactions are secure, they happen in a no trust environment. Blockchain have the mechanism to provide trust using consensus mechanisms. However, they come through an authenticated and verified scenario. Consensus, as I told you, that blockchain is a scenario where users do not have trust on each other. But however, they agree to the network because the transactions that they work on the network happened to come through a consensus mechanism where the transactions can be verified and validated. What are the benefits? Yeah, it reduces time, reduces cost, risk. What time does it risk? The transaction time that happens on blockchain is very, very less compared to on the other networks. Overhead costs, intermediary costs because of maintaining the centralized party for your business will be removed because you can run it on a peer-to-peer network. It also provides you security, thereby reducing the cyber frauds, crimes, risk, because everything is transparent on blockchains. Everything is visible, but however, it all comes with its own cryptographic backed benefits. And now this blockchain can be enabled into any business model that you can think of. One example that was given was IoT integration into supply chain. So this is the slide I am talking about where I can tell you why distributed ledger. blockchains became famous because of this distributed ledger technology. Now you talk about any typical system, traditional system that is there in this world, apart from those distributed scenarios. We work on centralized ledgers because of this centralized ledger scenario only. You know, when there is a server issue in Amazon, all the Amazon network gets down. When there is a server issue on Facebook, all this Facebook network, you, none of us will be able to access Facebook. So as WhatsApp, right? So that is a major disadvantage which centralized ledgers, centralized servers, where there can be a single point of failure if the major of the single one big server that functions fails. The entire network may collapse even for a few minutes. That is the reason people started moving to distributed ledger technology. You call it distributed ledger, distributed systems, more or less the underlying technology is the same. So what is it that happens here in this distributed ledger technology is that it is completely different from a centralized ledger, where in a centralized ledger, there is one single ledger which maintains the overall data of your system. If that ledger fails, everything collapses in your scenario.
And one more observation, madam, in terms of talk about scalability.
Yes. So
we'll go for a distributed scalability.
Hmm.
According to the researcher perspective, I am saying.
Yes, scalability when it comes to distributed systems, that is one parameter we can look into. Yeah. I'll tell you, I have, if you can see in the picture, decentralized ledgers is only the blue part. And then when it comes to the green part, all of them are distributed ledgers, but they address various scenarios. The one on the extreme left is a permission.
It will affect entire things. That's also another issue.
Sorry?
We are not using why we are, if you go for the centralized atmosphere, everything keep it that centralized atmosphere means obviously, the single point failure very often you will get.
Correct.
Yeah. So entire system get a collapse. But you go for distributed. So only one point is failure means it won't affect the entire process.
That is true. That is true. That is the other thing I was trying to tell you.
Yeah.
So distributed technology, you have the extreme opposite to centralized ledger is a distributed ledger where it is a permissionless public shared systems. Centralized scenarios, imagine a banking scenario, SBI banking scenario. So it is a centralized ledger, even only a particular set of people or in fact very few people have access to that ledger. They come with various access protocols, various authentication requirements to control the ledger. So if that one single or two people can be compromised, entire system gets compromised. But still, we all invest in banking, we all share, keep our savings in bank, all that is a different thing. Because of that no trust scenario, people started moving into this distributed ledger technology, where here it is a permissionless public shared system, it is a distributed system, where no user needs any permission to join into the network, and the transactions that happen on the network are publicly shared. Bitcoin is a major example for that. But however, the problem with distributed such an open permissionless shared system is that scalability is one problem. The one problem is transaction throughput is one problem. When you have so many people, see, when you have five people in a classroom, it is very easy to reach to a conclusion, very easy to come to a consensus. When you have 500 people in the same room or auditorium, or when you have, imagine 5,000 people, 50,000 people. So as the number of people start increasing, the consensus takes a lot of time. It takes some time to reach consensus. Okay, so transaction throughput is delayed a lot. So, you know, in Bitcoin, it takes almost 10 minutes for a transaction to be approved on an average, which is a very huge amount of time that we need to invest in our transaction. Whereas in the normal networks, digital networks like VeriSign, Authority and all, which are trusted third parties for such very business financial transactions that we do, it takes less than seconds to get our transaction approved. So that is the difference. One is transaction throughput. Then comes the second part where we move slightly towards away from the completely distributed ledger, which is these two things that that are there: permission public share systems and permission private share systems. With in these two scenarios, this also uses distributed ledger. It all has the advantages that we have on distributed systems and all. But however, they are not completely open systems. You know, if you want to be part of that network, you need to have some mechanism to get membership into the network. They are not completely permissionless networks. That is where my topic today starts, where I am introducing or introducing something known as permission blockchains. I'm sure the previous session was also about permission blockchains, so you got an intro on that. So permission blockchains are those blockchains which will give you what all the better features of blockchains, such as transparency, immutability, security, and all these things. However, the only difference compared to the previous blockchains is that you need some permission to be a part of that network. How do I get that permission? I'll let you know. So when it comes to distributed technology, it covers a broad set of uses. Suppose, say, ANITS is a college which wants to maintain its own blockchain, maybe to keep all the transactions regarding the students' transactions, the faculty transactions, non-teaching staff transactions, and all the things. Right? That is a good way to get transparency among all the stakeholders of ANITS. That is a very efficient way. But however, if you see why will ANITS College be interested in sharing its blockchain across the world? Right. Yeah, it wants to show transparency. It wants to have its transactions to be open to all the stakeholders of the environment. But why should it share it to the entire world? Right. Probably ANITS is not interested in sharing its transactions to the entire world, and vice versa. Why is everyone in the world interested in the transactions of ANITS? Right. So when there was no such common set of people who are interested in that things, what we do is that we opt for something known as permission blockchains, where the stakeholders of that particular organization will get access to the respective blockchain, and it blockchain functions in the same way. Only thing when it comes to Bitcoin blockchain is that Bitcoin blockchain, we don't know who the other users are, and we don't have trust also. However, in public permission blockchain, you know who the other users are, but however, you don't have the trust. We still try to achieve trust by using consensus mechanisms and all other mechanisms. And the advantage, and one major difference when we talk about scalability, is that Bitcoin blockchain is scalable. Any number of people, any number of nodes can join in the network. However, permission blockchains are not scalable. Permission blockchains are designed to address some set of participants, where you decide in the number of participants. You have blockchains for 100 nodes, you have blockchains for 1,000 nodes and 10,000 nodes. But however, after a certain point, scalability becomes an issue in permission blockchains. But when it comes to permissionless blockchains, scalability is never an issue. It is one global blockchain that is shared across all the nodes in the network. Privacy can be protected in blockchains, and the transaction throughput is very efficient in permission blockchains, but not in permissionless blockchains. I'll show you the differences or major parameters that we need to look into. So if you look here in permissionless blockchain, whatever read-write access to the database, when I say read-write access to the database, it can be reading the transactions from the database or blockchain, writing transactions to the blockchain, or verifying transactions to the blockchain. That can be done by anyone in the network, whereas in permission blockchain, that will be done by only those members who have access to them. They will get access by having some invitation to the blockchain. Scalability is never an issue in permissionless blockchains. It can scale to any number of nodes, but however, transaction throughput is a bottleneck in permissionless blockchains. Permission blockchain scalability is not so encouraged. You restrict to certain number of nodes which are large enough. However, transaction throughput is a very efficient factor in permission blockchain. Transactions happen very easily. Why is it so? Because you have a fixed number of users and you can always come to consensus by using some popular consensus mechanisms like majority voting and all these things. So how do you come to consensus in permissionless blockchains? You have mechanisms like proof of work, proof of stake and all. Permission blockchains, you have closed membership consensus algorithms. What are consensus algorithms that we use in distributed systems are applicable here. Identity of the users is not known in permissionless blockchains. So we are looking for anonymous users in permissionless blockchains. Although theoretically we say their users are not known, they are anonymous. I specifically personally would like to call it as pseudonymous because in literature, we have de-anonymization techniques to take our public key address back to the actual user. It was a bit complicated process, but however, it is not an impossible task. In coming to permission blockchains, the identities of the nodes are known. Transaction identities can remain still anonymous or pseudonymous. So then coming to assets, they have native assets, in the sense the respective currencies. If you look Bitcoin, it has Bitcoin as a currency. If you look Ethereum blockchain, it has Ether as a currency. When it comes to permission blockchains need not require any such assets. It can be either assets or data or state, change of state can also be a transaction thing in permission blockchains. So Hyperledger Fabric, the example that we'll be discussing in today's session is such a scenario where it doesn't have any currency sort of thing. But what all it works is on transactions where it can be a change of state, change of data and all this. Currency is required in permissionless blockchains, whereas it is optional in permission blockchains. Because as I told you, permission blockchains are more useful in enterprise scenarios, in business scenarios where you need not always be, it's about money, it's about agreements, policies and all these things. Bitcoin, Ethereum, Stellar are all examples of permissionless blockchains, whereas permission blockchains, Hyperledger Fabric, R3, Corda and all these things, we'll discuss about Hyperledger Fabric in today's scenario. The complexity is relatively linear in permissionless blockchain, but it is more combinatorial in permission blockchain. The reason is that in a permissionless blockchain, we work on a peer-to-peer scenario and all peers have the same access rights, same rules and responsibilities. When it comes to permission blockchain, it's not the same. Certain users are allowed into the network, certain users are not allowed into the network. Among the users that are allowed into the network, certain users can perform transactions, certain users can only view transactions, certain users can participate in consensus, certain users can may not be able to participate in the consensus. That all depends on how your business organization works, what is the hierarchy of or the structure of employee organization in your business organization. Throughput is low to medium in permissionless blockchains, whereas transaction throughput is high in permission blockchains. So let me introduce you about the topic of today's session about Hyperledger Fabric. Hyperledger Fabric is in fact considered as a major project. So it is a collaborative effort to introduce blockchains across the industry in various applications. It was first hosted by Linux Foundation and it is the fastest growing project in Linux Foundation history. Linux Foundation have many other projects, but they proudly claim that this is the fastest growing project in their history. And they have collaboration with various industries spanning from finance, banking, IoT, supply chain, healthcare. As I told you, you name the application, blockchains is there. So this is a pictorial representation on how to show you how Hyperledger Fabric has evolved. If you look into here, the Linux Foundation has other major projects like Cloud Foundry. Container is another major project of Linux Foundation, Node.js and all these things. But Hyperledger is one project We're under Hyperledger project. They are developing various frameworks: Hyperledger Indy, Hyperledger Fabric, Iroha, Sawtooth, and Burrow. What are all these things? All of them are blockchain frameworks. But only thing is that some of them are intended for specific things. If you like Hyperledger Indy, it is for more about creating independent digital identities and all. And if you look at Hyperledger Iroha, it is also a blockchain framework which is designed basically to incorporate into the infrastructure projects and all. Sawtooth is again to run customized smart contracts. The only difference with respect to Hyperledger Sawtooth is that Hyperledger Sawtooth can work on a permissionless environment also, while all others are more into permissioned environment. Okay, so Hyperledger Burrow is something. Ethereum is a permissionless blockchain, but Hyperledger Burrow is a permissioned Ethereum smart contract blockchain node. So with slight variations, each of them have various frameworks. Among all these frameworks, Hyperledger Fabric is a framework which is very popular among all other frameworks because it was being adopted in many business applications. The other beauty of Hyperledger Fabric is that it allows many pluggable options in its functionality. You consider it as consensus, you consider it as membership services, everything is a pluggable option. So making modifications in this blockchain framework is relatively easy. People can upgrade very easily for various other features that are provided by Hyperledger Fabric. So this pluggable option is one beauty of Hyperledger Fabric. These are the various members from the industry who are indulging in the research of Hyperledger Fabric project. So you can see many popular companies such as Accenture, Cisco, IBM. In fact, IBM played a very key role in developing Hyperledger Fabric. Some of the slides that I have taken here are from IBM Hyperledger Fabric related material available from their relative websites related to Hyperledger Fabric. Then this is history of Hyperledger Fabric, founded in 2016 as part of Linux Foundation's Hyperledger Fabric. What is it that uses? It uses a ledger, it uses smart contracts and a mechanism through which participants can manage their transactions. So by this time, I'm sure you know what a ledger is, what a smart contract is. What is it that it is slightly different is that Hyperledger Fabric is a permissioned blockchain. So new members of the network, any member of the network that wants to enter into the network can enroll through a membership service provider. Unless membership service is given to you, you cannot access the network. And it offers several pluggable options. As in when the slides come, I'll tell you what are the pluggable options offered at that point. And they store the data in multiple formats and it has switchable consensus mechanisms. One other prominent feature of Hyperledger Fabric is channels. So till now you talk about Ethereum, you talk about Bitcoin and all, they allow only one single channel where all the transactions that happen are recorded on one single ledger. But Hyperledger Fabric allows group of participants to create separate ledger of transactions. So suppose say we are a team of 40 here, some 7 people among us can form a channel, have our own set of transactions. The other 33 people need not even know that a channel has existed, because this is something in a business scenario to achieve more privacy. See, what happens in a business scenario, there will be tenders, quotations asked for various things. So dealer, when they want to quote, they definitely don't want to make it on a public domain. So what happens? He wants to keep the respective transaction very private to the people to whom he is interacting with. So I'll maintain a channel with him. I'll maintain a different channel with another dealer so that privacy is achieved. So channels need not be always used in any business, every business application, but those businesses that require privacy among the participants itself also uses these channels. I'll show you what is how do they work. Then what does Hyperledger Fabric contain? It contains majorly two things, shared ledger, and shared ledger is nothing but the distributed ledger, and the other thing is smart contracts. This shared ledger consists of two components. One is the world state and the transaction log. What is the world state? You can imagine world state as a database which contains the very recent state of the ledger at a given point of time. What happens is that if you take a particular variable value across the transactions, the value of the variable keeps changing. So if you want to know what is the very recent value of that particular variable, you can find it on world state rather than going through all the transactions in the blockchain. Then you have transaction log, which records all transactions that happened in the world state till now. So that is about transaction log. Then comes smart contracts, which are you know, you write your chain code, the business logic that is used in your application or in your organization is written as chain code, and that was invoked by an external application. And this particular smart contract mostly interacts with the database component, which is your world state. Why? Because when a smart contract gets executed on the blockchain, there will always be a change of data or some change of some value which will be reflected in the database of the respective ledger. I'm sure you already have some idea on these people which are, because I'm not introducing blockchains for the first time to you. You have been hearing sessions on blockchains. So to give you a very high level glimpse, these are the actors that are involved in a blockchain solution. One is a blockchain architect who designs the blockchain framework, and then if you look here, IBM is the architect for Hyperledger Fabric. Blockchain developer who creates various applications. Hyperledger Fabric is being used in healthcare, is being used in supply chain management, is being used in cloud industry, IoT industry. So you need to create various applications using blockchain as a framework. There will be a network operator who operates the blockchain, because, you know, in a blockchain, especially permissioned blockchain, you need a network operator who can give access or, you know, who can operate on various participants of the blockchain. Traditional processing platforms, these are nothing but you know, the regular databases from which way we gain access to the data of the respective applications. Membership services, through which you participants of the network will access security certificates. Even if it is every blockchain user who wants to enter into the blockchain need to get a membership service certificate from the membership service provider, and then only can access blockchain. Blockchain user, end users like us who does business to business transactions on the blockchain, we may not even be able to know that blockchain was involved underlying when you are accessing that particular business application. You know, the very popular example is the Dharani portal of Telangana government, where for land registrations and all they are using. I know there are a few hiccups there, but the underlying framework that they have used is to maintain transparency is blockchains. In fact, Andhra Pradesh government is also have a long-term plan on using blockchains for such transaction purposes. So this is about those uses. What are the components in this blockchain? Many of them, you know, ledger, where you maintain all your transactions, and it is maintained by every peer node of the channel or every peer node of the net. We generally say network, but I say channel because Hyperledger Fabric uses channels. Smart contract, this is a software, a piece of code where you write your business logic for modifying various, you know, various change of data, change of assets, change of states and all, and you run it on the blockchain. Peer network, where all the nodes connect together and they have some consensus mechanism to ensure the correctness of your transactions. Membership service is a service provided to authenticate the users where they get some permission to access your blockchain network. Events are not notifications that happen on the blockchain, which when a smart contract gets executed, something changes. So whenever there is a change in the network, that need to be notified to the end user through some form, through an SMS, through an email. How you notify, it depends on the respective application where you are going to implement it. So there is a systems management where you integrate all the blockchain components and you function your blockchain. This systems management is that place where you can, you can work on your pluggable options. Security, any blockchain that you want to access, you need an app or you need a wallet sort of thing to maintain your credentials, your private key, your public key, your digital certificate, signature certificate, and all these things. Generally, all these security credentials. So this is the ledger I was talking about, which contains two things. One is the regular blockchain, where each block will have transactions, every block hash is connected to the previous block hash and all these things. So it is a linked list of blocks. All the transactions are described on a block, and no block can be tampered because they all are related by the respective hash value. I'm sure the previous sessions have told you how they are immutable. But another thing that is specific to Hyperledger Fabric is the world state, where it stores the most recent state of smart contracts. So the most recent state is the change of state, the change of value, or sometimes the output of the transaction. This is stored in a traditional database scenario. And the data elements can be added, modified, deleted. All the things can happen. Anything that happens on the world state is recorded as a transaction on the blockchain. But what happens is that there can be some transactions which are not valid as well. So what happens when there are invalid transactions? They are still recorded as a transaction on the blockchain which was invalid. But still, the transaction is recorded on the blockchain. Anything that happens is recorded on the blockchain. So I'll skip this slide. Maybe you have seen this many times. So this is a ledger example. You will be accessing the respective blockchain through some application and you invoke the smart contract. This is an example I was telling you from a scenario of a change of ownership transaction. Suppose say I want to sell my car to one of you. So probably one example is that when that particular smart contract gets executed, this is like I sell a car to some person. So it happens on certain conditions, right? That person, we need to agree on certain amount of money. He pays me some advance. Then I start invoking the ownership transfer function. And once the ownership was completely transferred to his name, then I'll get the full payment and then I'll hand over him the certificate or whatever is there. So this is that smart contract where when I say set the owner as some new owner, what are those things that happen? So the respective smart contract gets implemented, that will invoke the respective contract. And whenever the invoking happens, it is recorded as a transaction on the blockchain. And whatever transaction that has happened, the recent change, so owner have changed from a person, some X person to some number 1, 2, 3, 4, that will be recorded on your blockchain. So this is how various applications interact with the Hyperledger. There is a blockchain developer who will be developing the blockchain framework with help of, and there will be some SDK for client application. And he'll also be the person who will be developing various smart contracts for the respective application. And when the client invokes the smart contract, he'll submit the smart contract with various inputs. Everything that he does is recorded as a transaction. It can be valid transaction, invalid transaction, null transaction, anything that happens, that will be recorded as a transaction in the blockchain. And also whatever change that happens to the world state, the database is updated in the world state. He may add data, he may put data, he may delete data, everything. And this entire thing put together, both the world state and blockchain, is referred as ledger in our Hyperledger fabric. And when the transaction gets accepted, rejected, it will emit an event as a form of a notification to inform the respective client. This is the Hyperledger Fabric version 1 architecture. As of now, Hyperledger is running on version 2.2. Not major changes. It has created a few patches, added some features which are not there in version 1. But this gives us an idea on how Hyperledger Fabric functions. And probably I will also give you some more insights. As I told you, as of now, it is working on version 2.2. Now, so if you look here, what is it that happens is that in the Hyperledger Fabric network, we will have certain nodes in the network where different nodes play different roles. We have an endorser. Endorser is a person who will endorse the respective endorsing policies. See, these Hyperledger Fabric is a framework basically used in various business organizations. So what happens? Every business organization have its own policies. The way my business functions may not be the way that your business functions. So what we do is that we write endorsing policies for our business organization and we keep them with the endorser node. So when a client, what happens when he submits a transaction, when he submits a proposal, the endorser node will execute his transaction and figure out, is it according to the business policy, endorsing policy of the organization. Then there are some other nodes known as committer nodes. These are the committer nodes who will be committing the transactions. You all are from computer science, you know what you mean, what we mean by committing the transaction. We make the transaction as final and keep it on the Hyperledger blockchain. The ledger, which maintains both your blockchain as well as your world state. Chain code is nothing but the smart contract that we refer to. Events are the notifications that we give to the end user. Apart from these things, whatever, suppose say when I give a transaction proposal to the network, some node who acts as an endorser will endorse my transaction. There are many such transaction proposals that are received by the network, and all those transactions that are endorsed by those respective nodes will be received by something known as ordering service. This is a mechanism on how you reach consensus in Hyperledger Fabric. Why is it kept away from the network? That, as I told you, that is a beauty of Hyperledger Fabric, where everything can be a pluggable option. So ordering service is some mechanism, some consensus algorithm that they keep in that ordering service, keep all the transactions in some order and commit them on the blockchain. But what happens, I don't like this algorithm, or there is some other algorithm that came into the industry, I want to change the algorithm. It is as easy as a pluggable option. You just remove this algorithm, keep a new algorithm. Okay? Apart from all this scenario, there is this membership services, where how you give membership to your nodes in the network can be an option. Again, as I told you, it is again a pluggable option. You have two different options available in Hyperledger Fabric. One is the certificate authority, which is given to a third party. It is something like a trusted third party. I don't engage in this business of giving membership certificates. What is membership certificate? I give him some public key certificate, I give him some digital signature certificate and all this thing. I just give it as outsourced to some third party, external authority. When a member of my network enrolls to me using that certificate, I allow him. The other is that Hyperledger Fabric itself has a component known as Fabric Certificate Authority, where it provides membership services. Which one you want to use is an option provided to the respective user of the Hyperledger Fabric. Before I go to the next slide, there is one feature that is not available in this screen, that is the pruning feature that is added after version 1.4 in Hyperledger Fabric, which is now again available in the recent version, that is version 2.2 also. This feature is that, what happens here is that what is it? It provides you a feature known as pruning. What does pruning means is that it will prune or it will trim off the unnecessary transactions from your block. What does that mean? As I told you earlier, any transaction that happens on the blockchain gets recorded on the blockchain. Any transaction, valid, invalid, null, unnecessary transactions also. That way, what happens? One beauty is everything gets recorded on the blockchain. The other thing is that your ledger becomes so ugly. Why did I call it ugly? Is because if you want to look for some transaction on the blockchain, it is like a dustbin. Everything is there. You need to figure out where your transaction is. It becomes such a tedious thing for you. So what happens is that Hyperledger Fabric came up with this option of something known as a validated ledger. Along with the actual blockchain ledger, it also maintains something known as a validated ledger. Where this validated ledger, we have only those transactions that are accepted in the blockchain. So these invalid transactions, null transactions, all such junk is removed and only validated transactions are kept as a record in the on the blockchain. This is a separate ledger that is maintained along with the actual ledger of the blockchain. If some user is interested in looking only a validated ledger, we look into the validated ledger, and don't worry, it has all the features of the blockchain, and only thing is that not every record is recorded, not every transaction is recorded on this blockchain. Only validated transactions get recorded on this blockchain, and you have various checkpoints to ensure all the other features of blockchain. It functions same as a blockchain, or it is immutable, and all these things. Then coming to various nodes that are there in blockchain, these are various nodes. One is committing peer, endorsing peer, and ordering node. Committing peer is that peer which commits the transactions that happen on the blockchain. It maintains the ledger and the state, world state, as well as it may also hold the smart contract because it need to ensure or verify the transactions that happen. Then is the endorsing peer, which is a specialized peer that receives a transaction proposal for endorsement. It will either respond or deny the endorsement based on the endorsing policy. So it need to check if it is according to the smart contract business logic of the organization. So it will hold, it must hold the smart contract. Then comes ordering nodes, where ordering nodes is a pluggable option, as I told you, but the job of this ordering nodes is to include your transaction into a particular block and then communicate them with committing and endorsing peers. It doesn't need smart contract, it doesn't bother about smart contract, and it also doesn't bother about ledger. The only job is it receives transactions from hundreds of clients. The only job that it need to do is how do I order these transactions? In which order should I keep them? In one way, how do I reach to a consensus on ordering, validating these transactions is the job of ordering node. So consensus is achieved with this transaction flow, with the following transaction flow in Hyperledger Fabric, where you endorse the transaction. Once your endorsement is approved, you order the transactions and then you validate or commit the transactions. Whereas in Bitcoin blockchain, you first order the transactions and then you endorse them and then you validate them. Because you are ordering the transactions without even knowing if the transaction is valid or not, consensus also takes a lot of time in Bitcoin blockchains, whereas we do the other way around. We first endorse them and then order and validate in Hyperledger Fabric. So there is a 7-step transaction flow that happens in Hyperledger Fabric. These are a few slides that I have taken from Mr. Jayachandran of IBM, who is working Hyperledger Fabric. He has even taught an NPTEL course from IIT, one of the IITs associated. So I have taken these pictures from them so that it will be easy for us to understand how a respective transaction flow happens. You know, when a transaction gets, when a client proposes a transaction into the blockchain, it goes through a transaction flow of seven steps for the transaction to get committed into the blockchain. The first step is the client proposing the transaction. Every client will access the blockchain using some wallet, using some portal where his respective keys are stored. So this is the client application on our screen where he is proposing a transaction and submitting to the Hyperledger Fabric network. As soon as he submits his proposal to the network, the respective transaction is received by the endorsing nodes of the network. If you look into the network, which is there in light lavender color, there are a few nodes E0, E1, E2 which are playing the role of endorser. There are a few nodes P3, P4. They don't do the endorsing. They are peer nodes, as we see. The nodes in green color are ordering nodes. Their job is only to do the ordering service. So when the client application proposes the transaction, the endorsing nodes will be receiving the transaction proposal and they execute the respective transaction proposal. If you look at on the right side, this is the endorsement policy, where the endorsement policy says that E0, E1 and E2 must sign or the others need not be part of the policy. There can be a different policy saying among E0, E1 and E2, at least two must sign. So what is my business policy? I write it on my endorsement policy and that endorsement policy will be shared or saved in my smart contract, or which is also known as chain code. So the client submits the transaction, the respective endorsing nodes execute the transaction as per the chain code which contains their endorsement policy. So this is the step where the endorser are executing the proposals. As soon as they execute the proposed transaction proposal, they will be updated in the ledger. As I told, anything that happens on the Hyperledger Fabric network gets recorded on the blockchain. So that will be updated on the ledger, and after the execution, whatever read-write values, recent updated values are there, they will be stored on your world state. So these, any transaction that is coming from client to endorser, endorser to orderer, client orderer to any other person, all the transactions are done with signatures and encryptions. I'll show you as a separate slide further. That then once the endorser executes the transaction, the endorser responds to the client by either accepting the transaction proposal or denying the proposal. If it is according to the endorsement policy, he will agree. If it is not according to the endorsement policy, generally his transaction proposal is denied. And there is so much transparency here that it is not an individual user who is signing on your application or who is rejecting your application. It just functions as per the chain code. So so E0 and E1 and E2, they are not individual persons, they are nodes in the network. So when a proposal is received by E0 node, the respective chain code gets executed and the output of the chain code is accepting the proposal or denying the proposal. So there is nothing like favoritism that happens here. So whatever read-write sets are returned to the application, then what happens? This respective E0, they send the response to the client. Then what will the client do is that whatever responses that the client received, these responses are submitted to the ordering service. Suppose, say, let us look at a very fair case, saying that, yes, my application is, my transaction proposal is approved, and he gets the approval from E0, E1 and E2. He will club the three responses, sign on that message and send it to the ordering service. The ordering service receives many such requests or many such transactions from various other applications. You can see three more are coming from the other side. So the ordering service receives all these transactions and then has to order the transactions and pack them in a block. So how does it do? How does ordering happens is that ordering happens in some ordering algorithm. In fact, Hyperledger Fabric has changed its ordering mechanism at various phases. Earlier, it used to work on something known as solo algorithm. Solow algorithm works on a first in first out fashion. Like first transaction that I receive goes first into the blockchain. That's how it works. Then because of the distributed scenario, rather than working on first in first out, it moved to Kafka algorithm. And then right now Appalachia Fabric is using raft ordering algorithm to order the transactions. So the job of this ordering service is to collect all such approved transactions, pad them into one single block. And once the block is ready, it will send this respective transaction block to all the nodes, especially to the committing piece. Generally, every node, this is a scenario where every node is engaged in committing transactions. There may be business applications where not every node can be a committing piece. So the ordering service collects the transactions, proposes them into a block, and then distributes them various committing peers. These peers will be working around so ordering happens in Solow, Kafka, right now, as I told, it is raft algorithm, which is again a crash fault tolerance algorithm. Then what happens is that these nodes, all the nodes, E0, E1, E2, P3, P4, VP, working, validating various transactions in the respective block, and they commit the peer. So once the transaction was validated by the committing peer, every node have validated the respective transactions. They are applied to the world state because now everyone have approved. If somebody have denied, then the consensus algorithm comes on which one to take as an approved output. Here, invalid transactions are also retained on the ledger, but they are not updated on the world state. World state only takes those recent values that are approved. However, as I told you, after version 1.4, apart from this ledger, it is maintaining also known as something known as validated ledger, where only valid transactions will store there. But this is that blue ledger where every transaction is stored on the ledger. Once committing nodes accept that particular transaction in the block, and once the block gets added to the blockchain, the committing peers will notify to the respective applications, meaning it will be the same client, various clients, that the transaction has succeeded, or the other way, the transaction has failed, whatever it is, that is notified to the respective peers of the network or the clients of the network. So these are the various key benefits of the transaction flow. Whatever business process that they have specified is reflected very much while they are endorsing the transactions, because a transaction has to go to the endorser, then to the orderer, and then to the committer. So the entire business flow process is reflected there. It will eliminate non-deterministic transactions, because when a transaction proposal is executed by the endorsing node, the endorsing node will make sure it is according to the smart contract logic that was already written into the business. So you don't find very vague outputs or in non-deterministic outputs from the transaction. And then the number of participants can be scaled in Hyperledger Fabric, but again, it has a limitation. It is not as big as Bitcoin blockchain. Transaction throughput is always faster in Hyperledger Fabric when compared to permissionless blockchains. So this is another unique feature of Hyperledger Fabric blockchains, that is channels. Channels are something that provide privacy between participants by maintaining various ledgers. So till now, whatever blockchain that you have talked about, they maintain only one single ledger, and all the transactions will be recorded on that ledger itself. However, Hyperledger Fabric maintains various ledgers. Okay, one is a validated ledger where only valid transactions are recorded, but apart from that, these channels will help them to maintain multiple ledgers, so that people who are working on a particular deal, particular transaction, particular scope of work, who want to maintain privacy with respect to other nodes of the network, will function and get their transactions updated on the respective ledger. It's only that I am not completely open, but my transactions are recorded on the blockchain on the respective ledger and all. If you look here in the picture, there are two nodes, E0 and E1. who are doing transactions and all. However, E0 is working on two ledgers. One ledger is represented in red color and the other is represented in blue color. E1 is executing only on red ledger, and probably E1 may not even have knowledge that another blue ledger also exists on the network. So this is a single channel network. All the peers E0, E1, E2, E3 connect to the same system channel. Here the channel was represented in blue color. All peers will be maintaining the same chain code, which contains AB as the smart contract, and the peers are all E0 to E3. But this is a multi-channel network. If you look here, there are various clients that are connected to the network, and peers E0 and E3 are connecting to the red channel, whereas E1 and E2 are connecting to the blue channel. E0 and E1, E3 nodes, when they execute the smart contract, they execute that smart contract which is with respect to chain code YJ. So the vendor sync policy and all is represented with respect to YJ smart contract, and transactions are reflected on this red ledger. But E1 and E3, they have different smart contract because they are working on a different deal, different agreement. So that is what your smart contract is about. E1, E2 works on AB smart contract, and the respective transactions happen or updated on the blue ledger. So that is about channels. That way E0 and E3 doesn't know the existence of channel blue. E1 and E2 doesn't know the channel, may not know the channel existence of channel red. Other thing is that there can be another channel, another node E4, which can have access to both the channels. The E may come in the higher in a higher level of hierarchy, who need access to all the channels sort of scenario. So this is a fabric peer. Any node will have a similar format, where peer can be considered as a node which contains one or more channels. If you look at this on the screen, this particular peer node is connected to 1, 2, 3 channels, a blue channel, a red channel, and a green channel. So the blue channel has its own ledger which contains blockchain world state. Red channel again have its own blockchain world state. Green channel will have its own blockchain world state. And these each channel may have its own respective chain codes as well. So these chain codes are shared across the channels, and each node, peer node, will be having its own local membership service material, which provides crypto material such as private key, public key, signature certificate, and all the things. This is a client application. Client application also uses the fabric, the development kit, to connect to various channels. It connects to, suppose say it wants to make a financial transaction, it will use blue channel. It wants to make an academic transaction, use red channel. It wants to do social networking channel, it will use a green channel, something like that. The purpose of each channel is different, and it will also have its own MSP that provides the client crypto material. Then we have Fabric Certificate Authority. As I told you, it is an optional service provided by Hyperledger Fabric, which provides distance certificates. We call them as e-certificates for us providing various memberships to the various nodes of the network. So it will support user authentication, it will support security, it will support database availability characteristics and all these things. The one more additional feature of permission blockchains is that permission blockchains, as we are saying, that they are individual, they are specific to respective business organizations. However, their scope can be expanded across the organizations. In the sense, a particular blockchain, Hyperledger Fabric, can be used across the business organizations, where in that scenario, you don't call it as permission blockchain, rather you call it as consortium blockchain. So the organizations will be defining the boundaries for your fabric network. This is a single organization scenario where your organization has certain administrators, users, peers, endorsers, orderers, and all these things. every organization has an ID. I will show you another scenario where you have multiple organizations. As I told you, in such a scenario, you have a consortium network. We have three organizations, organization 1, 2, 3 in this picture. And if you see, all three organizations are wrapped around Hyperledger Fabric Network, where organization 1 and 3 will be running the paid nodes and also nodes. Organization 2 doesn't involve in the transactions, but it will only do the ordering service. Or it can even, there can be even endorsing nodes in organization 2 also. Different scenarios, different combinations give you different consortium networks. What will the membership service do is that the membership service... Shall I continue? Okay. So the membership service provider, what does it do is that it will manage in giving you identities to connect to your fabric network. So it will provide identity for peer nodes, for orderer nodes, for client applications, administrators, whoever wants to access the network in whatever capability, they need to get this membership. So what is it that it will, who will give this membership? The identities can be issued by the Fabric Certificate Authority, an option available in Hyperledger Fabric, or an external certificate authority. It is choice of the business organization, where it provides you various services such as authentication, validation, signing, and issue of certificates. So how do they give? It will have different crypto standards that it can have. You have various transport layer security crypto material available in the respective transactions. What is it that it will provide you is that this transport layer security, it will use various cryptographic protocols to have a secure communication in your network. So what are those features that it will provide? It will provide privacy, it will provide data integrity. How do I provide privacy? Provide privacy by using symmetric cryptography to encrypt my data transactions. Public key cryptography to authenticate the identities of the communicating parties, because people who wants to communicate to me, they will use my public key. I read the data using my private key. So that way I use public key. I also use message integrity in my data to maintain my data integrity by using some hash functions. So that way I provide privacy, data integrity, authentication in form of non-repudiation and all. So, and communication among various nodes in the network is possible. A secure communication is possible across the peers, between peer to orderer, client to peer, orderer to orderer. Different combinations are possible. So this is an user node or a client node where the identities that he maintain or the identities that are provided to him by the membership service provider is that it will provide two things. One is a key store and the sign certificate. Key store is the private key which he will use for signing various transactions. And then sign certificate, it is available in a publicly available X.509 certificate format, which is approved across various internet protocols. So when you have a public key of this format, your public key is valid across many protocols. Then comes administrator identities. He also have a key store and a sign certificate in the respective format. Then peer and orderer identities. Peer will also have a key store and a sign certificate. However, orderers, apart from these things, they need to authorize the administrator of the network especially. So they have something known as admissions, administrator certificates, CA certificates. If I want to verify the other, public certificate of the CA itself, certificate authority itself, it is available. Among all these things, the most important thing is that it will also have a list of revoked certificates. What are revoked certificates is that the business network is generally dynamic. You don't have static, fixed number of participants in the network. New people join into the network, some people leave the network and all the things. So your system or your network should have a mechanism to address these two things. When new people join in the network, you should have a mechanism to enroll them. We have membership service provider who enrolls new users. Similarly, when an existing user leaves the network, his certificate should no longer be valid. So what the system does is that different systems follow different mechanisms, but they revoke their certificates. In the sense, if I leave the network, my certificate will be revoked. In the sense, my certificate will be removed from the acceptable list of certificates. So that when I do a signing using that certificate, that signature will no longer be valid. So that is the advantage that you have with revoked certificate. So a user who leaves the network will not be able to do any business transaction on your blockchain network. Your channel membership also will have these admin certificates, CA certificates and CRLS, but as it is, it will not have any private keys for its identity. This is how a new user gets registered and enrolled into the network. What happens here is that an admin will be registering a new user for the first time by enrolling his ID. So if I have give my ID to admin, admin will have access to the certificate authority, so it will enroll him with the ID and the system will give him an OTP sort of thing, a secret value. Admin passes on the enroll ID and the secret to the user. The user will be accessing the blockchain network by using this enroll ID and the certificate for the first time. So he will access certificate authority for the first time using these two things. He will get the respective e-certificates, his private key, his X.509 public certificate and all these things. And from using them, he will join the network and start making business transactions. One last thing before I close, I want to say is that it's not only the transaction flow, the transaction signing also is very secure in an Aperture public network. Every transaction, whoever will be doing transactions on the network, there should be permission actors and their signatures are validated at each and every step. Look at this picture. The client submits a proposal. We have already revisited the flow, but I'll just add it in from a signing point of view here. The client submits the proposal, but as in when he submits the proposal is signed with the client's certificate. So when the peer nodes or the endorser nodes receive them, they validate the client signature and they execute his proposal only when the client signature is valid. Once the endorser node validates the client signature, the endorsing the respective transaction proposal is executed and the response is again sent back to the client, but the response is also signed with the respective endorser node. Suppose say E0 node is sending the response is signed with his signature. E2 is sending the response, it will be signed with his signature. The client will validate the endorser signatures and then only he will believe in the response. And then once he receives all the responses are clubbed together and sent to the orderer again using client signature. The orderer will validate the client signature and then only will pack his transaction into the block and send it to the other nodes for committee for delivery. Once it reaches to the committing peer, the committing peer will validate all the signatures to validate the respective transaction. So it will have the signature of the client, it will have signature of various endorsers, it will have signatures of orderers, and all of them are validated for a particular transaction to get validated in the network. On an average, a particular transaction gets validated at least 6 times in the network before it gets committed in a Hyperledger Fabric network. So that's about Hyperledger Fabric. Okay, my next slide says Hyperledger Composer. Composer is a web tool where you can build smart contracts and build a blockchain. However, Hyperledger Fabric have stopped developing this Hyperledger Composer anymore. Right now, they are only into Hyperledger Explorer and Celo. So that's it about Hyperledger Fabric and permission blockchains from my perspective. So I'll leave the floor open for any questions.